Good evening and welcome to the Bennington Select Board's meeting. It's the, basically the second week of the month, right? These months go so fast. Thank you for all showing up tonight in this beautiful, hot summer, pre-summer day. But it's nice to actually make our way from the parking lot without rain, sleet, or hail. And so we're gathered here at the Bennington Firehouse, and it is June 12th. I'm Tom Jacobs, and I have the pleasure of being the Select Board Chair this term. I'd like to have my colleagues introduce from left to right.
Good evening. Hello, I'm Chad Gordon.
Hello, I'm Jeannie Jenkins.
Good evening. I'm Donald Campbell.
I'm Jim Carroll.
Good evening. Carson Thurber.
Thanks for coming. I'm Jean Connor.
And I'm Stuart Hurd, the town manager, and to my right is Linda Bermudez, the clerk for the board.
That's great. It is Flag Day, so if we could all stand, and if Carson, could you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Carson. And all. As is our practice, we do have a consent agenda that has been circulated to the board members, and I've also seen, reviewed, and assigned, subject to the board approval, the warrants for this month, or this bi-weekly. We have minutes of May 17th, May 22nd, and June 5th. I think there are a couple of absences from some of those or one of those meetings. So if we could accept a motion for consideration, and you could just indicate your abstention because of absence if needed.
Okay.
So someone give that motion, please, or make that motion.
Will the minutes be accepted?
And I'll second that.
Okay. Discussion relative to the content or the your appearance?
Jean.
There's one error here. I'm sure you probably picked up on it.
What is that, Jean?
Which date?
May 17th, right in the middle of the page, supposed to be served. There's a four in it. It's not a big deal.
Okay, no.
But the other one, the meeting from June 5th,
mm-hmm.
I know we talked several times about the tree, the possible tree work. I just would like some language in there to reference the possible tree work that relates to this project.
Okay. We discussed it, but for the reasons that we talked about, that was withdrawn for consideration, the actual project.
Right.
But you'd like that included in the consideration?
Something about trees, because it did come up at least two or three times.
Yep.
So I don't care where it is, just some mention of possible tree work.
Stuart, since you took the minutes, didn't you?
Yeah. I don't remember the discussion about tree work.
Is that not getting much?
I think the discussion was that there were very large, I mean, Jean, you brought it up, but
yeah.
there is at least one extremely large tree, and either the root system or the proximity to the wall might mean
there has
to be some tree work done.
Yeah.
And it could be costly.
I do remember that.
Okay, thank you.
That's it.
All.
Okay. Having that comment, would the board be willing to vote on that with that addition on the minutes of the June 5th meeting? All in favor signify by aye. And indicate your absence from any one of those, that we can have the record reflect that.
So I was absent.
On June 5th? Any other?
Yes. I was absent from May 22nd.
Great.
And I missed the 17th.
Having those noted in the record, we're all in favor of the minutes as presented, subject to those abstentions.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. We have the honor of having a proclamation tonight. This proclamation is to recognize the Bank of Bennington for years of not only existence, but its participation as one of the fine citizens of Bennington, because this institution is more than an institution. It's basically part of our fabric. So I will turn to my vice chair, and if you could read the proclamation.
Okay. Proclamation celebrating the first 100 years of the Bank of Bennington. Whereas the Bennington Cooperative Savings and Loan was founded on May 14th, 1917, and whereas it remains the only truly local full-service bank in the region, and whereas it became the Bank of Bennington in 1999, and whereas it has retained the highest rating, 5-star, by Bauer Financial for the last 25 years, and whereas, as a mutual bank, depositors have a say in its operation and direction, a unique approach to banking. And whereas the Bank of Bennington and its employees invest heavily in the community, supporting many local nonprofits with donations and time. And whereas its most recent and perhaps most significant community investment is the partnering in the effort to save and redevelop the Putnam Hotel, the Penny Saver Complex, and the entire Greenberg Block. Now, therefore, we, the Bennington Select Board, do hereby issue this proclamation to honor the Bank of Bennington as it celebrates its first 100 years, dated at Bennington, Vermont, this 12th day of June, 2017.
Great. You've heard the proclamation. All in favor of the proclamation as stated, signify by aye.
Aye.
Aye. That is 7 in favor of the proclamation. If we could sign it, I'd like to present it to Jim Brown, who is here tonight on behalf of the bank.
While everybody's signing that, I will say the Bank of Bennington is such a generous community partner. It just seems like you touch everything.
It's so true. And it really is. You can't say enough about this institution. Because as I said, it's more than just a bank. It's basically our neighbor and has been there and will be there. And as you can see, it's invested significant resources in this community. But the resources that it invests are from the community, which is pretty special because it is our local entity. And at 100 years, that's in a bank's time, that's a long time. Jim, if you could come up so I can present that to you.
Yes.
And moving into our part of our citizens' comment period, I do see that there is an individual that has signed up, Chris Bates. If you would come up, identify yourself for the record, and we will proceed from there. Please.
Chris Bates, Bennington. So I had this like two-hour speech, and as I was coming over here, I said, just crumple it up and get it out of here, so I'm going to wing it. So I want to give a huge, huge, huge thank you to Stu Hurd, our town manager, our assistant town manager, Dan Monks, Stephanie Calabro, the Green Mountain Hiking Club, I hope if that's the right thing. I'm not sure if that's the right organization, but the parking lot is a reality over at the White Rock. So no more parking on our yard, no more in our lot. But I also want to give a huge thank you out to the employees of the town of Bennington. They were wonderful. We worked with them. We let cars park in our lot where they were building the parking lot. If you haven't seen it yet, you got to go by. It's awesome. So I just want to, again, thank you guys for everything. So, and Steph loves it. She's like, oh, geez, nobody's parking in our lot anymore, and we can get out of our driveway, so.
I think it deserves like a ribbon cutting or something, too.
It does.
I'm sure that Stu and his staff could arrange, because it is significant. We talked about the importance of it. I don't know how active it is now.
Oh. So Mother's Day weekend, 31 cars over the whole weekend, no incidents, everybody knows how to park up there. I think it holds 12 cars, which is great. Some parked down the driveway there and some parked up on the driveway that goes up to the White Rocks. So it's awesome. You guys, thank you so much for everything and all your hard work that made it come true. So.
And the town employees should certainly be recognized.
Oh, they should be.
It wasn't an easy putting down some gravel and that's a parking lot. There was
absolutely
significant environmental issues that had to be dealt with.
Right.
And we appreciate you.
All right, so thank you again for everything. And you know, sure. The town of Bennington deserves a huge round of applause for that, because now it's on the map, like our keys in the middle of the street. So, okay.
Thanks very much. Yep. Appreciate
that.
Okay, we'll move right to the first business item on our agenda, which is the Accountable Community for Health. Doesn't seem like that's stated right, but we'll take it however it is, Jennifer. This consortium of individuals and entities have come together because there's a recognition that the health of a community makes it vibrant or not. And the underlying pinning for our foundation is a healthy community. And we're challenged for a lot of reasons, economically and otherwise, but there is this group of entities and organizations that have come together to address, not just talk about, but to address the real issues of need, health, and what this community needs. We're really fortunate tonight that Jennifer Fells, who is probably that's going to be the initiating the discussion tonight, because I'm sure she would like to have it as a discussion, to share with the community exactly what's happening with the accountable opportunity we have tonight. Thanks, Jennifer.
So thank you for having me.
I get a little closer to the mic.
Does that? Can you hear me? I have a soft voice. Okay. I want to thank my colleagues that are here with me. What I would do is I just explain very high level what the concept is, and then have my colleagues come up and do a brief 2-minute example, actually exemplify what this work looks like. It's okay to talk in abstract theory and models, but what does that look like for the people that live in our community? So Kathy Vogel is here from the Department of Health, our local director. Susan Scorbati, the director of Kappa at Bennington College. Billy Allard, the administrative director for ambulatory services at the hospital. And Stephanie Lane, the director of Shires Housing. And we have Dr. Dick Dundas from the Bennington Free Clinic. Dr. Dundas is here and he said he'll heckle us if we don't get this right. So our presentations.
That's great.
I have a one-page handout. Everybody's tired of PowerPoint, so this is the model that I'll walk through quickly. Looking at a grand scale, the United States knows it needs to do healthcare reform. I'm not going to get into the politics of ACA or not ACA or Obamacare. But in the ACA was written that we would bring up the health of our communities using some of these basic principles that's usually not discussed. So I'm not a proponent, I'm not here to talk about that, but I'm just saying that is a part of the recognition of the United States has to change its delivery of health care, and it comes all the way down to the community of Bennington. Vermont had some grant money, innovation money, from the Centers for Medicare and Medicare. Vermont received some of those dollars to look at how could we deliver health care differently. And the communities across Vermont, people in my role across the state, are looking to this model. And I'll walk from the left, and we had to define what health is. And we took a broad view of what health is. It's not a prescription, it's not surgery, it's how healthy is our community, and does the person living in our community, is the society healthy? Do people have well-being? Are they satisfied? Do they have a quality of life? So it's that broader definition. The model is evidence-based out of the Public Health Institute, and it comes from the World Health Organization also. And it is based on evidence that's pretty compelling on what makes a community healthy. And it's not more procedures, it's not more medicine. That is not working, we know that. A lot of money goes into that. It's not working. So it's a model at attempting to look at something different. Looking at the center column, you'll see that the evidence shows that there's components of what makes people healthy. It's your own health behaviors is 30%. Clinical care is 20%. If you envision clinical care as being medicine, physicians, nurses, hospitals, they got to be very good because they take care of us in our greatest, most intensive need. So you want good clinical care. Social and economic factors accounts for 40% of your health. Think of your own families. What makes you healthy? So you can eat right, you have access to good food, you have a safe place to walk, you have enough income to send your children to school, you have safe daycare. You're able to take care of yourself, you're able to self-manage your health. And then physical environment. Something that are the 9 essential elements on the far right, this is how we're organized. We have several organizations, and I'll show you those briefly when we go to the other side, is we're looking to organize. We're young. We've been in existence about a year and a half, so we're just learning. A lot of that goes with trust, trusting each other. Also, leave your ego at the door. This is time where nobody's the head leader, but how do we collaborate together and leverage all of our work? We know there's no new money coming in. I'm not here to ask for money, but how do we leverage what we do and how do we collaborate to be stronger and have good effective outcomes for the people that live here? I just heard somebody say thank you for a parking lot. So think about that. People can park safely. I mean, I don't know the details of that, but just that little bit adds that little bit to having a community that feels safe. Going to the other side is how we're organized. We have a charter is what you're looking at. We have our mission statement, and we've adopted the World Health Organization of what is a healthy community. In the center, you have who all of our partners are. I won't name them, but you can see these are people that normally would have not traditionally worked together. We come to the table, we look at the cost of healthcare, we look at the utilization of resources, we look at how can we better support each other to do our work better. How do we communicate about the people we're responsible for? Many of us are agencies or services that work in separate silos. We have criteria how we spend our money or what service we provide. But if we work together, one example is I work with Sadie Professor from Human Services, and we work with a group of children's services. How can we communicate and work better to keep this child and this family safe and keep them healthy and work with the medical system to make that happen? We have strategies and priorities, and they're in alignment with the all-payer model that's here for the state of Vermont. That's also part of the healthcare reform platform for the state. We're looking at improving economic and community development, healthy behaviors, reduce the morbidity of chronic disease, and decrease the incidence of adverse childhood events. So this is a very high level of our model and our structure. We have about, I just counted, we have 35 different projects. I just did a count of them. From big scale, small scale, and us working together and collaborating, subsets of other organizations working together to meet these strategic goals in our community. So that's the framework, that's the broad picture. As I said, we're young, we're developing our communication and how we can leverage our work together.
Jennifer, how do you measure both success and opportunity?
Success, we have several measures. We look at cost per capita of the population, of their healthcare costs, and we can break that down by ages, the pediatric population, adults, seniors. And also we look at various public health measures that would be people have access to food, nutrition, people feel safe. We also look at clinical measures, the incidence of chronic disease. We look at safety, we look at opiate addiction rates. So we run the gamut all the way from projects that are dealing with the opiate crisis that's across the country, and we have numbers and data on that. Human Services coming out with a database that will be accessible to the public. You'll be able to look at different population sectors and the health of those areas and what the opportunities are.
Will at some point there be a place where the public can go for basically a report
Yes.
or where things are so they can, we're not
I think there will be a campaign, and maybe that's something we can help with on how we can have the public know that there's access to this data and to say, oh, we have an issue with, you know, it's nutrition for grades, you know, kindergarten through three? Or is it smoking cessation? We do have a high use of tobacco in this community. Yes?
Jean?
So I can't imagine there's anyone around this table or out in the audience who wouldn't support your efforts. What's the role of the select board? Can you envision? There's probably many, many things,
yeah.
But...
Kathy's going to close with that.
Okay.
There's something called health in all policy. And as people come up and talk about their stories, this is not the entire group, but a sub, you know, people that could come today, listen to what they're saying, and then what Kathy has to say about health and all policy. So it's not an ask for funding or, you know, a change in what your charter is or your mission, but just start to think about when people come before you, is this healthy for our population? How does this augment the work in having a healthy community, that very broad definition?
Okay.
And I'll speak and they can kick me later, but any one of us would be glad to come back and talk about something, or to support you in decisions, or give you references or resources that might be helpful. It's a very knowledgeable group. I know this much. These are my colleagues that make this work happen.
Sure. I just have one more quick comment. I noticed in the partnership section, the school district is not represented in any way.
Because we're new, we picked people that were the most able and ready to do this. Schools are definitely a missing link in this, and we had some early conversations in the integrating family services. The schools are present, and I think that you will see that increase in the future.
Okay, that's good.
Definitely not everybody is here.
Good. The list will be added to. Okay, great.
So I'd like to introduce,
I've got some general questions here.
These are all admirable agencies, and it seems to me that you've collected quite a coalition of people. But my central question is to this is, it's really not clear to me, number one, what your goals are, and number two, how is this governed, and what person or entity would set goals to achieve the things that you would like to have done?
We're using the statewide framework of goals. There's three goals with the all-payer model. If you look at our strategies, those are the goals. It's to increase the access to primary care, reduce the incidence of chronic disease, mm-hmm. and to also address the reduce opiate addiction, and to reduce the rate of suicide. Those are the statewide goals. The national goals, if you reduce the incidence of chronic disease, you reduce cost. So if you look at the national goals, there's three. Reduce the cost of healthcare, you know, what we have now for healthcare reform. Mm-hmm. Improve the person experience with their health. And, it's to reduce the incidence of chronic disease.
Mm-hmm.
So introduce the health of the population.
Mm-hmm.
So Bennington. So our strategies are our goals.
Okay, but who among your group really serves the locus for
achieving these goals? An integrator role, and that would be SVMC. Is Southwestern Vermont Medical Center and the Vermont Blueprint for Health. We've done some evaluation of the community, and they're seen as the integrators, call the meeting, have the partners come together. However, they're not the boss. They're not the decision maker. It's the group. It's the coalition, if you want to use that term. It's our accountable community for health.
Mm-hmm. So who's the go-to guy or woman?
Chair of this is, we have the group here that are sitting here, the people here at this table, it's a subgroup, and myself and Dr. Jim Poole co-chair the group.
Mm-hmm. I think that's it for now.
For now, sure. Would you like to comment, or would you like to wait?
I think she has some other guests that we should let her bring up.
I'd like to give some examples, and then you can ask more questions, because I think it makes it real on how we work together. Stephanie Lane is going to talk about how does housing fit into healthcare? And she's a strong partner, and I think she'll be able to articulate very well how that's made a difference in the care of people living in our community.
Great. Thanks. Welcome, Stephanie.
Thank you for having
me.
So when I started at Shire's Housing and I learned about SASH, I said, housing and healthcare, interesting. Coming from New York and being an implant here, we didn't have a lot of connection between the two yet. We hadn't made that very logical connection between social determinants of health, such as housing and, you know, prevention and lowering costs. And I was introduced to this crew, and they invited me to be a part of the Accountable Community for Health and to take part in the workshops and to see how housing fits into this and what an important piece of the puzzle it really is. So, I mean, in a broad sense, you know, just physical condition and affordability are big factors in health and housing. But I'm here today to talk about the SASH program. And SASH is the Support and Services at Home program. Shires is considered a designated regional housing organization, or DRO, for the program. So we're our housing DRO, and there are housing sites that support the program as well. We serve 450 participants in Bennington County. We have two panels here in Bennington, and a panel is made up of 100 participants. We have one up in Manchester, and then we have 1.5 in Deerfield Valley as well. We employ 5 SASH coordinators, so 5 of our Shire staff are dedicated strictly to this program. So we're very invested in the program. And what SASH is it coordinates the resources of social service agencies, community health providers, housing hosts, not-for-profits, to support Vermonters who choose to live independently at home for as long as possible, and to keep them from transitioning to a nursing home environment for as long as possible. We serve seniors and individuals with special needs as well, who receive Medicare support or Medicaid support and live in congregate housing or in the community, so we're able to serve both. We have both congregate housing panels and we have community panels. They're very different, but we're able to serve both. The benefits are, you know, an improved quality of life, comprehensive health and wellness assessment, an individualized healthy living plan, access to classes, like we teach Tai Chi classes, we do COPD classes, we have, you know, heart health classes. We connect all of our participants with a wellness nurse as well, and any other resources in the community they may need, such as addiction prevention, or they may need to work with UCS, we can make those referrals. They may need help with their medications. We receive a notification when they're released from the hospital. So that's really important to know, you know, that they're going to stick to their plan once they've been released and that they have a safety net when they get home. And that's where the doctors can sort of hand off to the SASH participants, and they can coordinate for continued need, maybe with a visiting nurse at that point. Some of the partners that we work with locally, the Bennington Area VNA and Hospice, Senior Solutions in Deerfield Valley, Southwestern Vermont Council on Aging, the Southwestern Vermont Medical Center, of course, UCS, and United Health Alliance. So I think, you know, one of the really important things to say is that in the last report done regarding the SASH program, it was discovered that in the more established panels, they saw savings of as much as $1,536 per beneficiary per year in Medicare dollars. Mm. So I think that's really important to note. And it's in the older panels where the folks have the stronger relationship with the SASH coordinators, and those relationships have been built with the partners, but I think that speaks volumes to the work that they're doing, our SASH coordinators. And I think that's all I have generally, unless you have questions about SASH specifically.
Prior to the collaboration, these services were somewhat available, but maybe not in the continuity or as organized as they are now?
Right. And it's part of a bigger picture of community health, we feel, and part of the social determinants of health. So, you know, these are our collaborative partners in trying to form this bigger picture of what community health is, and focusing more on prevention than on treating you know, and less emergency room visits, and a healthier place to live, a more affordable place to live. It's all part of it.
Great. Please,
so are you able to serve everyone that needs serving, or?
We are not able to serve everyone. No, we have a limit, so our limit is about 100 per panel. And we have 4.5. We will sometimes push the limit a little bit if our SASH coordinator feels that they can do that. The community panels are tough. There's a lot of travel involved. But we do have some attrition just naturally, you know, because a lot of them are seniors. We may get to a point where we can offer additional slots, but right now, the funding as it stands, we can't. So, you know, we currently do have some vacancies, but it changes. It changes
pretty regularly. So the funding for this is federal dollars?
It's Medicare and Medicaid. It's also through the DALE program and DIVA as well. And there are a lot of contributors. You know, there's a list of contributors also.
I have a question.
Please, Jim.
So the contents of this document, these are more aspirational at this point. Is that fair to say?
I think it's an aspirational model. Yes, it is. Yeah, it's an aspirational model, absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I'm just curious, you know, if you've,
it's
I hope
picture.
That you have, and I'm sure you probably have, thought about the ways that you're going to measure the success of these aspirational goals. And maybe one of you could speak to that. Okay. That's it.
Good question. Anyone else? Stephanie?
Could I just
please
switch here? I just had one question.
Yeah.
And it's not even a question, it's a comment. So on all the openings here, the partnerships, so I'm starting to align different people with the different ones.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a cheat sheet somewhere? I mean, it's the website we could hop on just to figure out the best point person that's in connection with each organization. So whether it be Shires of Vermont in this example, or Jennifer or Billy or somebody. I mean, I know some of them just by default, but other ones that might be good for the general public watching to want to find out, oh, I know that organization. I didn't know they had a partnership with this other organization. Just might be a worthwhile exercise. And it might be just adding a name next to the slide.
Great.
Thanks.
Thanks, Stephanie. Yep.
Good evening. Susan Scorbati, the director of the Center for the Advancement of Public Action at Bennington College. First, I want to say that Jennifer Fells really introduced me to this concept of a community health model, and it was really groundbreaking for me. I had heard these kinds of ideas before, but until she really described this to me and got me involved in this coalition and community-based effort, I'd never really connected things like education, food. I mean, I knew these were all connected to our health and well-being, but when you really start to think this way and understand that we're so interconnected with these different programs, the fact that we can really network and bring people together to think about the health of a community, I just cannot say I think this is so important. So it's really transformed how we've thought about a lot of our projects, and I'm a big proponent of what the hospital has been facilitating with this community, so I just wanted to put that out there. So for Kappa, we've had really now several projects thinking this way about health. Everything from, I'm going to say just very briefly about the food clinic and a project that I just came from a meeting today that's brought a lot of partners together in Bennington, which is for a great project. But we've also done things, I think, like you've known, the PFOA issue that the college has been very involved in. And we do a lot of education in the schools. So we have a lot of partners in the schools right now and different programs that we're doing, everything from Bennington Elementary to Molly Stark to the middle school to the high school. So I'm thinking about health in this very broad way in terms of the projects we've now been involved with. And Jennifer and her team have been really good about giving feedback about the projects when I call and ask for different kinds of questions about things. So I just want to say this is a specific project to give you an idea. We found out we have a food clinic that meets once a month. Just to give you an idea of the groups that come to the food clinic, the Greater Bennington Interfaith Council with the Kitchen Cupboard, BCRC, the Vermont Department of Health, the Abbey Group that does the food for all the schools, the hospital, the schools themselves are represented in their programs around food, local people, farmers that come from local farms, students from Bennington College, and community citizens who show up. It has mainly been out of a need that people wanted for a network so that they could just come once a month and share information about what they're doing in the community. A lot comes up around nutrition. A lot comes up around access to food and issues in Bennington around access to food. 2 months ago, we were through Sue Andrews and Hunger Free Council. It came to our attention that in August, there is a big problem for children with access to food in the town of Bennington. That is because the free lunch program ends August 4th. And so in that gap between where it starts up again, we were told that many, many families, I know a number was literally said 1,000. I think we need to check exactly what those numbers are, but they're much larger than what anybody would think about in Bennington. So this group of partners that I just mentioned got together and said, we need a name, and they called it Harvest for Kids. And we are going to now sponsor a month in August in Bennington where we're going to feed the children of Bennington. Any child that needs access to food is going to have it. It will be done through the Kitchen Cupboard, the Greater Bennington Interfaith Council. They have been incredible. They've been fantastic about helping us organize this and be the host place where the food will be handed out. It will also happen in Pownall. It will happen for the whole month of August. There's a challenge going out. BenningtonCares.org already has a website for Harvest for Kids. You can go on it and volunteer. We need a lot of volunteers who are going to cut up vegetables, etc. And there's a team challenge where teams of any place, community, nonprofit, can form a team, make a pledge, and by the end of July, donate what they've come through. That's all on the website at BenningtonCares.org. So this is a community effort. This is an example of how you translate health from an idea, an aspiration, a way of thinking about health in your community to an on-the-ground actual project. We'll be able to determine how many children came and accessed the food in terms of families. So we'll be able to know that data by the end of the summer. And we're hoping, because we've already gotten great response, even just right away, from all kinds of different people, that if enough money and support is raised, that Harvest for Kids will continue. It will not just stay in August, but it will become a year-round program in whatever way that the community feels would benefit the children of Bennington. So, just want to give you an
That's
idea.
Just great, Susan. Just staying with that project, I take it that all of the collaborative partners are basically knowledgeable or participating to some degree so that the word is out. And I think that is one of the challenges that our community has had to demonstrate the existence of a program and also to serve and then to report the success. And this collaborative allows that to sort of come together so that we'll be able to see and make sure no one slips through the crack.
Yeah, and so thank you for the opportunity to even bring it up tonight. It was kind of a coincidence that it happened this afternoon, and I also want to thank Donald Campbell, one of your selectmen, who's been fantastic with students at Bennington College who have been very interested in food through the farmers market and other tutorials and things that they're very interested in food and nutrition, college students right now, and sustainability and agriculture. And so anyway, I just wanted to also.
Jim? Yeah, I just have a, first of all, I want to say thank you. The thought that people like you and others have made it a point to feed poor kids just calls to mind the stories my mother told me as a kid, growing up in the Depression and going hungry. And there are people like you that are willing to get out there and feed the poor. And I'd like to be of any help that I can with this. That's it.
Thank you. I want to say that this is a real community effort. You know, I mean, I'm here speaking about it, but the people sitting here tonight, all of them have contributed to making this happen, particularly Greater Bennington Interfaith Council and BCRC. Yeah.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you very much.
Really? Such nice to see familiar faces and hear. Good evening, Bill.
I'm Billy Allard. I'm the Administrative Director of Ambulatory Services and Transitions of Care at Southwestern Vermont Healthcare. And I have been on the most exciting journey of my career in the past 4 years. Prior to that, I was a nurse in the hospital. In fact, I was a chief nursing officer at North Adams Regional Hospital for 8 years and had always been in the hospital setting. And the reality of healthcare right now is that at our health system in Bennington, 80% of the care is delivered outpatient. Only 20% is delivered in the hospital. Yet a lot of the resources are still in the hospital. So part of my challenge from my CNO, Carol Conroy, and from Tom D, the CEO, was to begin to think about healthcare. How do we decrease the cost, improve the patient experience, and improve the outcomes? And we set out on a journey and put together a transitional care program. So we have redeployed expert nurses that have spent their whole life in the hospital, and we partner with patients with chronic disease that are confused about their medications, don't understand their discharge instructions, are in the hospital a really short period of time, and go home sometimes without the necessary support structure. So that nurse has an ongoing relationship with that patient for up to 3 months. They sometimes go to doctor visits with them. They share that crucial information from one doctor to the other, to the nursing home, to the rehab setting, and they help that patient get in a place where they can be safe at home. Nurses who spent their whole lives in the hospital, we never saw the reality of what's really happening in the home. And there were many aha moments that, oh my goodness, you know, these complex discharge instructions don't work. They're thrown in a corner and nobody even reads them. We have to do something different. So we've come up with ideas like a magnet that's on the refrigerator that has red, yellow, green, and in big letters tells them what to do with their chronic disease. That's much more useful than the pile of papers we sent home. We now are redeploying pharmacists to help the primary care doctors with patients that are on 30 medications, trying to figure out, can we put them on less medications? We are helping patients that are discharged to the nursing home not come back to the hospital by, again, collaborating and empowering the staff in the nursing home to react more quickly to their symptoms. And we, one by one, are looking at where are the gaps in care delivery in Bennington and how do we fix them. And we're being supported by the health system to redeploy the resources that were in the hospital to get them where they really need to be. We are on a mission together in this community, and I have to tell you that Jennifer and I have been speaking about this nationally. And we are way ahead of most of the rest of this country with the cutting edge work that we're doing. There is so much good work happening in this community. There's so much promise because all of the community partners are willing to come together and to really pave the way for how do we make healthcare affordable? How do we combine as a community and take care of the people that really need to be taken care of? You know, I would say that in my whole career as a nurse, I always wanted to be able to make a positive change, and I believe in this community with this wonderful team of people, we have the ability to do it. So now we're really ready for all of you guys to come on board with us and help us decide where do we go from here. You know, as far as the data, I can give you some data. The transitional care nurses have partnered with over 1,000 patients in the last 3 years, and we've been able to decrease their admissions to the hospital by 50%. That's a lot of money. Some of those patients were coming in all of the time having huge workups, and they're happier not coming to the hospital all of those times. We've been able to decrease their emergency department visits by 20%. Again, a huge cost savings.
That's fantastic. It really is.
Other data, we have another team called the Community Care Team, and I'll leave these for you so you can see them. And what we found is patients with addiction and mental illness tend to hang out in the emergency department. And some of them come 3 times a day. And what they need is not emergency department care. So they would come with a headache, they'd have a really expensive workup, but what they really needed was somebody to care about them. Maybe a job, maybe some social support, maybe a different place with other people living with them. So we put together a community care team, and again, it's part of this whole team, and they meet monthly. The patient signs a consent that this team of people from our community can come together and see if we can come up with a better plan for them. We have been able to decrease emergency department visits by 40% for that,
is that locally?
Group of patients. That's right here.
Wow.
Yes. And it doesn't mean that we don't still have the other people coming. There's new and different people coming, so that we have a steady stream of the ability to really look at these patients. And at the table is housing, is workforce development, is the soup kitchens, it is United Counseling. 15 or 20 people come together, and they love the ability to share, and everybody gives a little piece of information, and then sometimes we can come up with a plan that works. So again, it really is very rewarding work, and you know, I think we're on the edge of going to the next level, and that's why we're here to see you today.
Great. Thanks very much.
You're welcome.
Anyone like that?
Before you leave, it sounds so great, and the you know the collaboration and the strength of collaboration sounds really amazing. As a complete ignoramus on the topic, I really don't know. I don't know how all the pieces fit together, and I can't imagine how complex it must be. But how does in very general terms, how does the money work? So I could imagine that as you have fewer and fewer patients in the hospital, which sounds like a great thing, and are using more and more services like housing or food or something like that. I can also imagine the insurance companies don't want to pay for any of that stuff. So how do you kind of make that financial shift?
You know, I would say that the hospital has taken a risk with redeploying these resources out of what used to be delivering care in the hospital. So that's on the hospital's dime. And the way that that works is that soon we should be in a value-based payment structure, where high-cost care is not going to be supported, and us being more efficient will be the way to go. So that's kind of how we've laid the groundwork for that. I think there are resources available in the community that haven't been tapped into. And so we're really using existing resources. We're getting groups of people to care about the food. You know, the hospital used to throw their food away at the end of the day. We're not doing that anymore. So we're finding the waste, and we're finding all of those opportunities and all of those resources that exist, but we're not being utilized because we weren't a cohesive team. And we were working in silos. And now we're really figuring out that it takes a village to get this done, so we've got to bring that group of people together.
And that's a great explanation, thank you. And so to go to the next level, is it a kind of about money? Is it about manpower? Is it about political will? You talk about kind of you're poised to go to the next level with
this. I think Kathy is probably going to talk about that, but okay. You know, I think that we want to get into the schools. We want to get to the kids and make sure they eat healthy and they exercise. We want to have sidewalks so that people walk more. We want to have walking trails so that we really encourage people, support them, that they don't need money to be physically fit and to eat healthy.
Thanks.
Great. Thank you.
Welcome, Kathy.
Thank you. Hello. I'm Kathy Vogel. I'm the district director of the health department here in Bennington. And earlier you asked, so what does this mean for the select board? I'll direct your attention to your second handout that Jennifer gave you called Health in All Policies. So what we really request of you is that you consider health in every decision that comes before you. So even the ones where you may think, really, what does this have to do with health? Every decision that comes across your table has to do in health, with health in some way, shape, or form. So to be healthy in Bennington, we really need to focus on the social determinants of health, which are things like transportation, healthy food, access to healthcare, access to affordable and safe homes, and also a spirit of connectedness in the community. So our ask really is that you collaborate with us and other groups in the community that are working towards this. As Jennifer said earlier, any one of us are willing to give you any resources that we can, whether it be data, technical assistance, consultation. We really just encourage you to consider health because it's lurking everywhere, and all you have to do is consider it.
Great. You put it all we have to do.
Okay, we've got an explanation on that.
Yeah, but we're happy to do it. But, yes.
Good. Jennifer, would you have further comments or anything to wrap up?
No, I think I'd just like to I want to thank my colleagues. They're a great partnership. You only saw a snippet of the work that's happening. It's very positive. Yes, you're right. It's an aspirational model, but if we don't have that, we have to have those aspirations. And you asked about outcomes. There's a lot published on outcomes. We're happy to share that. I do have, there's plenty of resources on data. One example I'll give you and I'll close with is the Blueprint for Health, the Vermont Blueprint for Health, invested $22 million to have case managers in primary care and behavioral health specialists to address high-risk patients. The savings from that, once you carve out that $22 million, and Bennington's a part of it, the savings was $73 million. So it's putting investments not in fee for service for doing things to people, but helping people to address those issues to keep them healthy. So it's a shift. Whatever the healthcare reform is, whatever they're going to call it at the national level, in Vermont it's the all-payer model. And Billy right now is saying the hospital is funding this, those nurses to go out there. They're not getting paid for that. That's something that they're doing, is that the payment model will shift to keeping people healthy and not for the, as we do things to people, we get paid. So thank you. I want to thank my team for coming. I couldn't ask a better group to work with. So we're happy to help in any way.
We just might have a question or two.
Yeah, no, Kathy, I'm wondering, can you talk about Rise Vermont? Is there any update on that?
So we're not calling it Rise Vermont, Jeannie, but we are looking at creating a community collaborative that does focus on health and embracing healthy lifestyles, which is the Rise Vermont mission. And we are looking to roll that out within a month. And Jeannie, because you put me on the spot, I'll put you on the spot because you were on my list as one of the people to invite. So I do hope you'll join us.
Okay, would love to.
But for those of you who don't know what Rise Vermont is, it's a movement and its tagline is embracing healthy lifestyles, and it just encourages folks to make the healthy choice when they can, to exercise, to eat right, to live in and support healthy communities. And we are very much interested in rolling that out in Bennington and making it Bennington's version of it.
Thank you, Kathy, and thank you all. I mean, it's interesting. If we heard from just one of you relative to what you're doing, it would be great. But by itself, it's sort of like there's a vacuum. And what you're doing is closing that vacuum and putting the collaboration together to address these many issues that we have. And as I said right at the outset, it's about a healthy community and how you all work together, how we all work together. That's what's going to make our community valuable and vital. Really appreciate your time tonight. It was time that we hope was well spent, but it was certainly well received by us, and we appreciate it.
Is this a model you developed? You folks developed?
The transitional care or the...
No. The collaborative.
I think the state of Vermont...
The state of Vermont had some grant funding to do innovation through Medicare, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid, and we received some money at the state level. They decided to look at what would be a good model for the state, and they used the public health model. That's what you see on your sheet, you know, looking at definition of health.
So you in large part developed this, is that right?
Yeah.
Every community is developing their own version. It looks a little different. St. Johnsbury has a group that's working hard on this, Rutland, you know, so it's... We all go upstate to Waterbury, we learn about this, we work as teams, and it's a very collaborative learning process.
Well, I wish you all the success in the world, and maybe, you know, this will catch fire and go all over the country.
Well, you know, the blueprint's been around. You were, you know, right in the base.
Bennington was an initial pilot in this work in 2006 with St. Johnsbury.
Yeah.
We raised our hands and said, we'll dip our toe into this. We don't know what'll happen, but we think that we know what's working isn't, you know, what's, you know, the current state of healthcare. It's too expensive. People aren't satisfied. We're not, and it's not, it doesn't mean that people weren't doing a good job. It's how we were fractured, and now we're coming together and supporting each other. So it's still people doing very good work that they've always done, but we're just supporting each other much stronger.
Thanks very much. We appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
That's okay. That's okay.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much. I want to apologize to folks that came to during the citizens' comment period because the sheet that I got had one name on it, and I do see that there's an additional sheet, so I think we'll go back to citizens' comment if I can do that for the board's approval. Bill Stewart is on the list, and I apologize for that. Bill, we're trying to get better at these things, and hopefully we will.
That's okay. I understand you need a little time to get straightened out. My name is William Stewart. Good evening, select board members, town members. I had a short agenda. My question was about the problem that we have still on Bradford Street and the Morgan Spring. I noticed on Wednesday that Dan Monks and a bunch of water commissioners or people from the town, and my guess was Vermont Pure or Morgan or out of Albany, they're the other water company, Crystal Rock,
right,
out of Albany. It seems like there was quite a crew of guys. I videotaped it all, and I was just wondering if something had changed or something's come about from that.
Stewart,
I can try to update not only Bill but the community. As you know, we initially thought we might be able to find a way to reduce or mitigate the traffic on Bradford Street by using our own facilities. That was not going to work. Since that time, and Bill witnessed part of the beginning process, we are now exploring off-site areas where we might be able to engineer a way to transport the Morgan Spring water to an off-site, more in a commercial area, not in a residential area, and provide access there. Partnering with not only Vermont Pure, but potentially the Pittsfield organization, and you said the name,
Crystal
Bill.
Rock?
Not Crystal Rock, but Ice River.
Crystal Rock and Vermont Pure both own.
Yeah, they're the same, but the group in Pittsfield, which is purchasing most of the water at the present time, is also willing to get involved. We don't know what it will look like. We don't know where it will be. But we've just begun that process to try to eliminate the truck traffic on Bradford Street. And in the interim, I've asked Ice River and its drivers to not park at the lower end of Bradford Street while one truck is filling, to find an off-site location where they can sit, and as the other truck leaves, that will indicate to them that the place is free, and they will move in to their own facility. I don't know if that's in play yet, but we talked with them a week ago after Bill had contacted me via email, noting that the issues were still there. So we're working with the folks who are taking the water to try to mitigate the traffic in the interim. And at some point, we will probably be back to you with a proposal that will take the water away from the spring and perhaps allow us even to increase sales if it works.
Do you have some reasonable optimism relative to that prospect?
I have some reasonable optimism, but then I'm a reasonably optimistic guy.
Okay, yep. Well, we have to have that otherwise.
Yeah, I think there are at least two, possibly three possibilities that we might be able to utilize.
Yep. As you say that, I noticed since I talked to you about it, or emailed you the other day about it, that starting on Friday and today, there's only been five trucks in there since. All day Friday was five trucks, and all day today was five trucks. So I don't know what's going on. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing, but I don't know what's going on, but I have noticed that the traffic has completely stopped threefold. I mean, it went from 15, 16 trucks down to five trucks a day, which I think anybody could live with if that actually would ever happen, but I doubt that's ever gonna happen.
I don't know that has anything to do with my conversations. Right. I was just trying to eliminate the two trucks on the street at one time. I think that may just be a period of time that you're going to get the benefit. I don't know that it will hold.
Right. You could actually have the windows open for the whole weekend from Friday to Monday, but that was the question I was asking. I see what was going on. I just wanted to pose the question. What's going on?
Feel free to keep in touch with the board and the management relative to it, because we think we need a long-term solution that meets the community needs and the neighborhood needs.
Have you guys even thought about it amongst yourselves about bringing the water to our town and bottling our own water and making millions for ourselves instead of sending it to somebody else to make millions of dollars? Why don't we keep the money for ourselves instead of giving it away?
Yeah, I agree.
Yep. We actually have looked at that. We've tried to entice on a number of occasions different developers to come and open some sort of a facility here. The problem with that is it costs a lot of money to open a bottling facility and a bottling plant, and beyond that there's the operating costs which drive the cost of water, which is why you're paying what you pay in the store for bottled water, and we're selling it much cheaper than that. All we're doing is pumping it out of the ground. We're not bottling it, we're not maintaining it, we're not maintaining the workforce, we're not maintaining health care and pay. So at the present time, I think that plan,
well, the cost of our water needs to go up, so we need to make more of a profit on our water, because if we're only selling for less than $100,000 a year and they're making tens of millions of dollars a year, the difference between it really makes a lot of sense to me. When they're making tens of millions of dollars, I know the cost of making and building, and I'm sure there's a lot of properties around that you could retrofit to sell and buy water. But the overrun cost of it and the outrun, we got 6 years left on this contract. If you took all the money they make in 6 years selling and actually brokering our water, because they don't really sell it bottled water. Only 25% of it that I was told is actually bottled water. The other 75% is actually brokered. It's taken to Crystal Rock in Albany, it's stored, and then it's sold as somebody wants to buy it. So as we sell it for pelts and beads and shiny stones, they're making tens of millions of dollars off this water. Besides the problems that the traffic and the nonstop tractor trailers are pulling in and out in front of my house every single day. It doesn't really offset, you know, what it takes to build it and make that money in the long run, considering the traffic and the trucks and the inequality of life on Bradford Street. It's not a drag strip, it's not a truck depot, but it is now. And that's the forefront that I keep trying to bring up, the fact of this. We could be making this kind of water or this kind of money for ourselves, and instead of letting Crystal Rock have, you know, exquisite rights to taking this water and doing what they want with it. Because that's exactly what they really do with this water. I follow the trucks. I follow them all the way to Albany. They leave here, I get in my truck, and I follow them all the way where they take it in Crystal Rock down in Albany. And they store it. There's huge tanks, as high, 10 stories high, holding this water. Because they store it in Albany.
And that's fine. That's, I know, that's, I mean, they have the infrastructure in place. They have the manpower.
I always say it's part of the contract, but you made the contract, the 20-year contract that's allowing this to go on. And nothing's really being done about it. It's being talked about, it's being pushed around, but really doesn't ever have to come to an exact answer on it. I know the cost is high, I know everything's high, but in the long run, millions of dollars for the town to make millions of dollars just selling something that comes out of the ground, why are we giving the money to somebody else to let them have the money and the profit from it?
Those are, you know, all valid points. I don't think even start to dispute those.
I was going to say that was a rhetorical question, not requiring an answer at this time.
Yeah, but no, the essence of it is the board, through management, can continue to look at this, and maybe we have to go outside to get, you know, an outside consultant or someone that has.
Well, I know we talked, you and I talked about it, that it was all pre-decessed. I know you guys really don't have an idea what actually brought this whole thing into effect, and I have copies for it for you before I leave, so you can, I can update you on how this whole thing started, how the whole thing ran through, and where we are at right now.
Yeah, and I'm concerned about, as you, what's happens from tomorrow.
Well, before I leave, I'll have a copy for all of you.
Okay, thanks, Bill.
Okay,
yep.
Good evening, thank you.
Thank you very much.
I just got one question for Stu. When you talk to these other people that want to purchase our water, and you talk about an alternative place for the water to be pumped, are they willing to chip in with the infrastructure cost, or have you not approached that?
Well, that's the conversations we're having, Jack, is you know, what kind of skin are they going to have in the game?
Good.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you very much. Have a good evening.
Yeah, you too. Mike Bethel. Mike, again, I apologize, Mike, I missed that sheet.
Can I make a suggestion? Leave the sheet over here rather than two places over there, because then people would see it.
Where?
They're used to seeing it. Sign it right here if you want to speak.
Yeah, that's probably good.
I'd like to ask you not to sell the 44 acres on Middle Tonnell Road. I think you all got a letter from me. I think we could use that land. You don't know what we're going to need it for in the future. We just made $128,000 on it. It's only valued at 70-something, and to bid to just the neighbors, I think, is kind of stupid. You legally can do that, but I think you need to, if you're going to sell it, open it up to the whole town. The whole town owns it. I believe we've owned it for 40 or 50 years. Stuart, you correct me on that. So it's not hurting anybody. If the town owns it, like Don Campbell does with his land preserve, nobody is going to affect those neighbors. They're not going to have a negative impact on those neighbors because it's going to be town owned, and we can harvest it again. And Don, do you know how many years it would take to harvest that again, roughly, to make that kind of money off the top of your head? Or
it'll be a long time before some of that land is harvested again.
But it would be harvested again on its own.
Clear cut. Well,
25 years.
At least.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's still 25 years if you pay $2,000 a year. And you just made $128,000, you don't know what the wood will be valued in 25 years.
It's complicated forest management. I mean, it could be, you could regenerate it to hardwood, in which case it could take a lot longer than that, but it's...
But I just think it needs to be, you guys were...
Yeah, well, basically, I think we understood at that point that it was basically landlocked, only of particular value. We've since learned that it's not landlocked, so that would certainly enter into the equation of value going forward.
And I believe you can build a few houses on it, I've heard. If it's not,
I expect, you know, it probably depends on the zoning out there, but I wouldn't be surprised. Is it? Okay. But again, that's in the marketplace. And, yeah, exactly, yeah.
And it was brought to you and you did it in one meeting. I wish you would delay the bid and all of that and just kind of think about it and maybe re-look at it. Because it is everybody's land. Everybody that.
Yeah, if we get an offer tonight, we have to actually have a public hearing relative
to it. Yeah, we've offered it to the adjoining property holders. The bids are due on the 15th of June. We'll review those at the staff level, and if there are considerations to be made, they must come to you for a public discussion and a public approval. So the approval is to convey the property. Once you see what the offer is, once you understand what stands to happen to the land, then the board gets to approve the conveyance. After that, there's a 30-day period where people can appeal or petition to block that conveyance, but that's the process that the statute sets up, and that's the process that we're in.
But the board doesn't have to take a bid either, does it?
No, we don't.
Okay.
But this isn't just between these two adjoining abutting properties?
There are four abutting property owners.
Four. So, but if anyone wanted to make a bid on these, they could.
Well, at the present time, the invitation to bid went only to the four individuals. If somebody wanted to come in and throw a bid in, sure. But, I mean, you start to lose your credibility if you set up a process and you invite people, specific people, to bid, and then all of a sudden you throw the door open and say, well, we're going to take it from anybody.
My suggestion is we continue in the process. We entered into it in good faith, and at the end, we get to look at it and then decide whether or not
if you want to change the process
it.
At that point, then that's fine. You can decide to hold the land, you can decide to open it up for public bids, anything that you wish to do.
So you'll have further discussion on it before you accept the bid?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
I appreciate that.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Pat, sorry. Do you remember why you're here? Yeah, no, I apologize. We're new to this signing in arrangement.
Sign in and all that stuff. You guys are getting modern here, eh?
We're getting what?
Getting modern.
I don't know. Sometimes you'd say it's just the opposite.
I really want to know if you select board know what the people out in our town are saying about the select board not having a checks and balance on what's going on in our town. So I'm just bringing that to your attention, you guys. At the town meeting, I brought up we should have a priority list for all the bonds that we got to go get, which we're getting for a highway garage, sewer plant, possibly a fire truck. And is the bond for the sewer plant going to fix the whole thing? Do you select board members know that?
Yeah, basically we haven't even seen the design or the cost estimate. I'm expecting that like next meeting or next, pretty soon, I think.
Should be ready probably mid-July. To late July.
It's out on the street that there's a figure out there of $11 million, and that's not going to take care of everything. So
That's going to be a good question for the community and also
future.
The board to ask, because if we're going to spend $9, $10, or $11 million, we're going to have an idea of what it's going to do, and I expect we will.
Yeah. Okay.
But that's, no, I appreciate that, because
I'll be here in 2 weeks, keep track of you.
Okay.
Go pull George Sauer. He used to come all the meetings.
That's
I'll be
right.
Here, boys.
We're nervous about it, too, if it's any consolation to you.
Thanks very much, Pat. Are there any other folks that were not on the list for whatever reason that would like to just talk with the board tonight? Please.
There.
That's okay. We can hear you. Can you hear Mike? Mike, can you get? Okay.
I have a question as to what's going on with the senior bus.
The senior bus? But maybe Stu can answer that.
Senior bus has been sold.
Who did it come to?
Pardon me?
Who did it come to?
The town.
Why?
Because it belonged to the town.
Actually, it belonged to the senior bus.
The seniors raised the money to buy the vehicle, but the vehicle was under the name of the town and has been since it was purchased.
I don't think that's there.
It's a fixed
we can't
asset.
I think
remember this is a trial period with the new relationship with Green Mountain and with the Council on Aging, and I think we have to see how that goes, and if it works and can be in improved and can be enlarged, I think that's a good thing. And I understand that the current relationship is working pretty well. Yes, it's only one trip a month, but I understand that people are enjoying themselves and having a good time, and at less money than they were paying before.
Are you interested in how much the bus was sold for?
The bus was sold for $1,200.
Yeah.
We had two bids, $500 and $1,200. The bus will not pass inspection following June 30th because of rust on the side panels and under the new guidelines of the state of Vermont. So there's a lot of body work that would be required to get that bus back on the road. The frame was somewhat corroded, but not so far gone. But a lot of the underpinnings, the brake lines, and those kinds of things were all in pretty tough shape.
Can you reserve those funds for the seniors?
Well, it goes into a sale of fixed assets, and that's what will show up as a revenue. If the board decides to set that money aside for the senior program, that's fine with me. I don't have any problem with that.
Would you have a recommendation on that, one way or the other?
At the present time, I don't have a recommendation. We just concluded the deal and moved it out of the town office parking lot, and and a young couple, or I guess they're not that young, but a couple bought it, and they plan to try to renovate it and use it productively. But it wasn't anything that we could have taken out.
Okay. Could I make a suggestion? This lady has got my number. She wants me to kind of speak for a little bit. I was going to think later about it, and I was going to come up tonight. But can one of you selectmen, one of you people, get in touch with this lady and some of the elderly people, and find out what their real need is? Just had a half an hour or more presentation of people with wellness in our community. These folks, the elderly, which we're all getting to be one, they need some attention, they need some clarity. Stu, you know, is trying to be as clear as he can. But I think one of you people, the select board, could go to these people and ask them, what is the real problem, and try to solve it. This has gone on and on and on. And they just, this lady, how many, three ladies just said about well-being, mental, and people, and, you know, if they can only get out one time a month, and they used to get out two or three, we need to do something about that. We can't just have organizations come here and give off a big spiel about 501c3s. That's the fastest growing industry in our community. And here's the elderly we have, and like I said, we're all getting older. I hate to hear, I've had many of them call me, and I said, well, Stuart's, you know, answering your questions, but you guys need to look into it.
Well,
see
well,
what we can do better.
Yeah, I think it's a good, you know, good point. In fact, a year ago, Michael Keane and I went and talked with the director and a couple folks for a couple hours, it seemed there, and got a feel for the organization. I'm not aware of the issues relative to, other than what we've heard about the
transportation
part.
This is their big bugger.
And that seems to be an issue.
There's a lot of them can't drive anymore, or they can't drive at night,
yeah.
And they want to come to even meetings, and they can't do it, or they want to go on trips. And if we're really serious about the well-being of our community, the young and the old, let's start doing something for the old.
Well, Mike, you know, I've got to pipe in on this. You know, I've gotten contacted any number of times through the town office with specific concerns. And anybody in this town can call the town office and ask for any select board member. They'll get me that message, or anybody sitting around this table. And I've always been responsive about that. And Madam, if you have a concern that you'd like to speak to me specifically about, please go through the town office. You'll get my, whatever your message is, will come to me directly, and I'll return the call. And I think that goes for everybody here.
So why does everything that we seem to do or they promise to, if you should go around it, then that's when you know whatever we wanted. Oh, that's already been decided.
Well,
seriously, it does.
Yeah, well, here's something that I learned in the very first year that I was on the board. As you may remember, I had my food cart on Main Street, and people would come to me with complaints and concerns and would want a specific solution to whatever their problem was. And what we as board members have to do is follow the law. It may not be the answer that you want, but the answer that you'll get is what we have to abide by. And it's not always what you want to hear.
Well, nobody's asking.
Pardon me?
I don't feel like you're honest.
Who's not honest?
really go
okay,
on.
Okay, thanks.
Just somebody go meet with these people and find out.
If all you have to do is contact us.
If you don't want to do it, let me do it for you, and I'll come back to you.
All they have to do is contact us.
Okay, I know. I'm talking about not contacting individuals. The board set up an idea to find out how to resolve the elderly's transportation problem in the community. So this isn't rocket science, and maybe we can't do it. Maybe you might be right, or Stu might be right, maybe we can. But get somebody to come back to them and give them a definite answer. Yes, here we can, here's what we need, do what you want, but we can't.
But aren't we in a trial period right now, Stu? Aren't you getting information back? Are we not in a trial period working with Green Mountain?
Yeah, Green Mountain and with the Council on Aging. The Council on Aging is subsidizing the longer-term trips.
Yep.
Green Mountain is subsidizing the short-term trips through federal funds that they have that provide specific activities for seniors.
Mm-hmm.
And we obviously, we started the program when we knew that the bus was no longer operational. Basically, we thought it was going to be sold for scrap. This is a trial period. We're going to see how it goes. We're going to see how effective it is. And I think people in the community must realize that there is a public transportation system here that you can ride. You can flag down the bus and ride. It also goes to the door and picks up people if they make the call. So I know the senior program, that group of people specifically had a bus that was for them. And we're trying to serve the senior program as best we can with the help of other agencies.
So when will the trial, I mean, so how, when, at what point will organizations and seniors that are using the service be able to give feedback? I mean, is there a, we're doing this for 6 months, we're doing it for a year?
I think 6 months is a good number.
Okay.
And we'll probably be able to report back come October and maybe perhaps deal with additional funds if they're needed in the budget process.
Okay, that would be great. And then I'm assuming that would include comments at that at that time. We would also be getting feedback from those who had been using it. So it sounds like it's really new.
They get to tell us what we can do, how long before we have things. We didn't have to do that before. We didn't know where we went. I feel like somebody has something against seniors. There's one working person left, and all the rest of us are volunteers.
How frequently before this once a month program started, how frequently were you able to get out of town? Was it once a week?
We have a lot of trips.
Yeah.
And the thing that is, if you say, next Thursday, want to go on a trip, we can do it. We all put money in, and we go. Don't have to ask anybody.
Well, let's see how this interim period works. And but those issues should figure into that.
Is there anything we can do about increasing the frequency?
That's a money-driven issue. Currently, the process is the director, the program director, contacts Green Mountain or the Council on Aging, says, here's the trips we have planned for the next so many months. How can we do it? How can you help us? What do we need to do? It's supposed to be driven by the senior program in contact and in concert with those two agencies.
So who would this lady have to contact?
She knows the director of the senior program.
Who is the director of the senior program? Let's start there.
Susan Hogue is the
current
program.
So she's in charge of making the requests?
Yes.
Okay. Could you guys call Susan Hogue in?
Yeah, I'll talk to her. Sure.
Call her one or ask her to make a presentation and see what these folks need. I'll gladly volunteer to help them, you know, if you want a liaison from the board and the seniors.
I think we can handle it.
Yep.
We don't need a liaison.
Pretty confident, Mike.
Huh?
You said he thinks we can
I think we can handle it.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
And you also got this other group. Maybe they've got money. Mm-hmm. Maybe they've got money. The group that just presented that might be able to help the seniors out.
But we're only in month one of a six-month trial period, so let's give it a little time to figure out what's
Thanks very much.
What's
Thank
true.
You for your comments, too. It's really, I understand that.
I would have to go out of my mind if I didn't have something to do. We stay busy. I don't have nothing. I don't pay me nothing. Mm-hmm. But I want to lot of seniors treated there, and I don't think they are.
Thank you.
I have to take my mind. Because I see all years gone, coming to affluence, they don't solve it, they don't matter nothing. They don't want to get this job. Mm-hmm. Because we're no further ahead now than we were before. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for your comments. Yeah. Thanks. I appreciate it. Tiff, we're going to have some discussion relative to that on the 38,000 foot because it's probably one of our major issues that we're facing in this community. And by all, we should know Tiff frontwards and backwards, but I'll tell you, every time I open any kind of narrative and email from Fred Kinney, who I think is going to be in town tomorrow, or someone else, there is always other areas that need to be considered. But maybe Dan, for the community as well as the board, just sort of give us where we're at because of the opportunities that TIF now provides.
Okay. I'll be very brief and just and I'm happy to answer any questions, but my goal today is just kind of to outline the process that's necessary for us to go through as a community to gain TIF approval from the state and therefore allow us to bond for infrastructure improvements of infrastructure. You all had in your packet, but I'm going to go over it for the public's edification. Email from Fred Kinney, who is the executive director of the Vermont Economic Progress Council, who is the state agency that will be reviewing and hopefully approving our TIF proposal. And he outlined the process very succinctly for all of us, and I'll just go through it again, like for the public's edification. He outlined nine real quick steps, or not quick, but succinct steps. First is learn about the program, and we're doing that. We've done that, and we continue to do that. And we need to learn everything that's new about the program, too, because of the new legislation. So we're continuing to do that, and we'll work towards that goal as we work through the whole process. The second step is to inform VEPSE of the municipal interest in the program. We've done that. Fred Kinney is actually going to be with staff tomorrow to start talking about that, the process in more detail of how to proceed with the TIF proposal. And then the third step is to seek local approval of the TIF plan and create the district. And that's really where we are right now. We're about to start that right now with our consultant, White & Burke. Stephanie Henley will be down end of this month to kick that process off. And I'll speak in more detail at the end of my comments about that, what Stephanie and White & Burke will be doing for us later this month to kick off that process of developing the TIF plan, creating the district, and getting local approval, which really means your approval, select board approval. The fourth step in the process is, once that plan is approved by the select board, is to file an application with VEPSE to gain the state's approval, which is VEPSE's approval of that TIF plan, that TIF district. And the reason that that's important is we don't have access to the significant education fund tax dollars unless the state approves it. So we have to file that application. VEPSE then will review that application. They have at least three meetings to review that. One of them will be a public meeting, at least. One of them will be a public meeting held in this community. The other two will likely be held in Montpelier. But they will have three meetings to review our application prepared by White & Burke and approved by the select board. Our hope is that VEPSE will be convinced that the application meets all the statutory requirements. That's step six. They'll approve the application. Step seven will be to seek specific approval from VEPSE on the financing plan for the TIF district. In the TIF district plan, you identify infrastructure improvements, public infrastructure improvements, how much they'll cost, what they're likely to leverage in private development, and the financing plan is a plan that shows VEPSE and the state that we have the necessary projections in place to support any debt that we may incur. The final step, and it's well, next to final step, is the toughest and the most important, and that's local approval of any debt we incur to incent improvements. That will likely happen in one, two, three, several votes. In other words, you don't go out and and seek approval for all the infrastructure improvements that you want to do all at once. You pick the ones that are going to incent projects that you feel are likely to occur, and therefore you can be able to cover with that new tax revenue generated the debt, and therefore there's no burden on the taxpayer. And that's really the most important consideration is making sure that this program, and that's what VEPSI does, that's what we do as a staff and a select board, make sure this program has no negative impact on the local taxpayer. Final step is implementing the TIF district and filing our required annual reports. We have to report at least annually the debt incurred, the debt that's being paid off, the improvements that are being made in the TIF district. So it's a fairly detailed reporting requirement, and that's the last step as we continue on in the life of the TIF district. More importantly, because it's right in front of us, we are looking to kick off this process with Whitenburg end of June, and just to kind of give folks what that kickoff will look like. Stephanie Henley with Whitenburg has been busy reviewing all the documentation that we've sent her on studies. She's also looking at census data, everything that she can to get a good picture of the community, specifically the downtown area, which will be the subject of the TIF district. Her team is doing that right now as we speak. They'll have all that under their belt when they come down later this month to meet with staff, with the chair and the vice chair, and other select board members at the stakeholder meetings. That will all happen the end of this month as we kick this off. And what they will be trying to do, Stephanie laid out pretty specifically the kind of things that she's going to be trying to kind of tease out in that meeting. And I sent an email to you folks, but I think it's important to let the public know really what Stephanie's trying to accomplish at that meeting. First question is, what's Bennington's TIF story? Well, why do we want a TIF? Why do we need this tool? You know, that's what she's going to be asking, and we're going to be attempting to answer as that process kicks off. What's our history of our development efforts here in town? And she wants to make sure she understands that so she can put her efforts with the TIF in into context. And then probably one of the things that we all know should have to do, and one of the most important is, what do we think the conceptual boundary of the TIF district is? Where do we want to draw that line? What properties do we want to include? And she'll start to think about those things with our help and stakeholders' help. We're going to discuss the infrastructure barriers to development in the proposed TIF district. What sort of public investment has to be made in order to incent this private development so that we can grow our grand list and improve our community? And then following on that, we'll discuss what are the potential private projects that are out there. What can be incentivized by this infrastructure? And then at the end of the day, they will do a tour of the district so that she and her team can get familiar with the area. And I should have mentioned, in the middle of the day, we'll have a stakeholders meeting. We're going to invite all the property owners in the downtown improvement district, all the tenants that we can get addresses for. I think we have a pretty comprehensive list of that. Tenants of properties in the downtown district, select board, obviously, chamber, the Bennington Downtown Alliance folks, so that we can have a kind of a meet and greet with the consultants, so that folks that will be directly impacted by this will have an opportunity to understand what Whitenburg is going to be doing, and she's going to make an effort to make sure that she gathers information from these folks, and we'll be following up with other folks with folks later on as the process continues. Again, this is just the kickoff. And then after that, what will happen? What will Stephanie be doing for us at Whitenburg with her team? They're going to analyze the district boundary and determine, you know, what really makes sense. Where should that boundary be? Obviously, the ultimate decision is up to the select board, but we're looking at Whitenburg's expertise to help us make that decision. They're going to do development and analysis of infrastructure costs and timing. You know, how much is the infrastructure going to cost? How does it need to be built in order to most efficiently incentivize the private development? What are the private project valuations? Projections. We need to know that so we know, can that private development support the debt that's going to be incurred to support them with public infrastructure. Tax projections will be made, and estimate of bond and payment schedules will be made. All that needs to happen as Stephanie or team develops a TIF proposal that will come to the Select Board for review and approval, and then follow the steps I discussed earlier to get state approval. This process will be a very public process. The state will not consider a TIF proposal that does not meet stringent public outreach requirements. That's in the statute. It makes sense, even if that requirement wasn't in there, we're going to be asking folks for money. We're going to be asking folks to approve bonds so that we can use the additional tax revenue generated to pay for public infrastructure. So we need to convince folks, A, that it's not going to cost them any more than it is today to bond for this folks, for this money, and B, that the development's very likely to happen, and that we have confidence in the proposed projection. So we want as open and public a process as possible. We want everyone to understand what a TIF is, and it takes a little while to get it. I know I read it probably 3 or 4 times before I finally sunk in. This is how it works. It makes a lot of sense. But until you take the time to really do that, and it's up, we need to make sure that everybody out there understands that. You know, this is truly a tool, an excellent tool for incentivizing development that will not burden the taxpayer. And we need to make sure that everybody understands that and they feel comfortable with that and they understand it. And when they go to the polls to vote for the bond, they feel confident, yep, that we're doing the right thing here. So that's kind of the process in a nutshell. I'm happy to answer questions, but that's
where we are.
You're going
to get asked the same question by the board and by the public. Again, maybe the same, and you'll get tired of hearing the question because it is an educational tool and a process that we've got to make sure our community is brought along. We don't want to get too far ahead of the community. We want to make sure that our citizens are educated. So that, you know, this is not like buying a fire truck and we bond for the 10 years or 15 years. There's a bond, but this bond is to be paid back with funds that would normally go up state for the educational fund, I believe, right? A certain portion of it. So that money, rather than going upstate, will stay here to support the payment on that bond. A big difference than signing up for a standard bond scenario.
What needs to happen is in the proposals, every cent that's paid for the bond is a cent that wouldn't have been generated but for the infrastructure we build with the bond. So that's probably the hardest concept to get across to folks is we're not adding a tax burden because there will be additional taxes generated by the private development that occurs because of the public investment. So it's a little tough to wrap your head around, but once you think about it, it really is an excellent tool for us as a community to improve the community without burdening the local taxpayer. And that's why this is such a powerful tool. That's why the 7 communities that fought for the TIF districts in the legislature so hard because they realize this is a tool that can really be transformative for a community without burdening the taxpayer.
And I really am remiss in not, again, thanking our local legislators from the senators through the entire House contingent, because this wouldn't have happened without them driving the process. And frankly, in the time that I've sat on this board, this is probably the first time that I've seen that unanimity of effort. Everybody's come together. So there's a recognition that it's not only benefiting Bennington, but it's benefiting the region, the Pownells, the Woodfords, the Shaftesburys, and the like, with this type of activity. One of the things that folks are going to say, well, does that mean we're going to build a civic center on such and such a street? That does not mean that by this process. Maybe we need to define what infrastructure really means in a development that we'd be looking at.
Typically, public infrastructure involves things like public parking, water and sewer infrastructure, any kind of utility infrastructure, streetscape improvements, roadway improvements, sidewalk improvements. Anything that improves the public realm is eligible. It doesn't mean that you build a building for a private developer. That's not, it's public infrastructure. It's infrastructure that we all can use, that we all benefit from. So it does need to be, they're very strict about where the money can go.
The but is, if there is a private developer that comes in with a civic center idea,
yes,
there is the underpinnings to support that development. So rather than investing, the community investing $10, $15 million, it's already been invested as part of that project, and then the civic center developer will build the building. But it enhances that ability to recruit that type of activity.
Perfect example is what happened in St. Albans, where they had a private employer who needed to add several hundred employees. They wanted to add on to their existing building downtown, but there wasn't enough parking, even if they added on to their building, to support those. Where are those new employees going to park? So St. Albans, through the TIF district program, built a parking garage. It's a public parking garage. Anybody can use it. But it supported that development. They could not have built that addition. They could not have hired those new employees without that parking garage. And that parking garage is also leveraging a downtown hotel project. So that public investment is used to leverage private investment.
Thanks. Folks, other thoughts?
I'm really glad, Dan, that you and Stuart encouraged us to hitch up with Whitenburg early on and get this process underway. And so thank you for, it felt a little early when we weren't sure which way the TIF district legislation was going, but I think your advice was good, and I felt like we had good support from our town staff on this.
Yep.
Making the decision a lot easier, so I'm really glad we're in the position we're in. I wonder if, have they talked to you about a calendar on this very much in terms of these nine steps, or how
yes and no. I mean, we've talked about it conceptually, but we will be putting together a very specific project schedule after the kickoff meeting, which will happen at the end of this month. And we have to make sure that we have the necessary public meetings and everybody has an opportunity to comment and that we get everybody's input. But we would like to move rather quickly because we want this private investment to happen. And we know there's momentum. We don't want to lose that, and we want to make sure that we can incentivize that private development in a timely manner. Mm-hmm. Honestly, I think that if we take a year to do this, probably not timely enough. So I think we have to really think about this as something we need to work hard on to get the word out, make sure we solicit aggressively comments and input early on and make this happen as soon as possible. So it will be an aggressive schedule. We will do everything we can to make it move along as quickly as possible.
Great, thank you.
Jeannie, Chad. Yep, I'm sorry, I always do that.
When we get to the educating the public piece, which is going to be huge, I think it would be a great idea, if possible, if someone from St. Albans or one of the other communities that's gone through this process and has had a really positive impact on the community to come and speak to that. I think there's nothing more powerful than, a real scenario that played itself out. So if that's possible,
I think it's a great idea.
That'd be really powerful.
I know that Stephanie worked with Dom and the team up there. So hopefully, if we can't get one of them to come down, maybe we can have Stephanie tell that story. But it would be really powerful if we get the town manager of St. Albans to come down, because he lived it from day one.
Right.
And he was actually instrumental this year in the legislature, because he told his story to all the legislators that would listen to him. And it's a powerful story of how St. Albans really did benefit from this and other tools. This is not it's not a panacea. This is one of many tools, but it's an important and powerful tool if we can use it correctly.
I just want to recall for you, Jeannie, the meeting that we had, I guess it was about 3 years ago now?
Two plus, yeah.
St. Albans had, I think it was an 80% vacancy rate.
Plus, yeah.
And after this transformation, it took them 3 years. I think the vacancy rate was down to just 2 or 3.
It was under 5%.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was they're a success story. Their Main Street is a success story for sure.
I don't want to spend a lot more time on this tonight, but I think it's going to be an ongoing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This is a priority for the management, which you've already taken and run with. The media is so critical and it's so helpful. I really appreciate your help during the legislative review period. And
and we want to make sure that we continue to get the word out that this, that we're we've got momentum, mm-hmm. and we want to keep that momentum going, because this select board is, we want to ride this right through and get it to the voters as soon as we can, having in mind that we've got a lot of education to do, because folks are already impacted by their own economic situation, and our hope is that we can demonstrate an improvement to the town economic condition. All right, if we move on that?
Great.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Appreciate
Thanks,
it.
Dan.
Are we to the point of manager's report?
I think we're there.
All right, thanks.
The only action item really that I have are basically to establish dates. I believe it was the board's idea to perform the charter committee interviews in the evening of June 19th and the evening of June 20th. I can't remember, they're in your packet here, the applications are. I think that we may have at least 9, perhaps 10 or 11. Ultimately, they're in alphabetical order, so it's not to show any favoritism. And we'll begin it, if you all say yes, we'll begin to establish that those interview times at 15, 20-minute intervals, probably from 5:15, 5:30 to no later than 7 o'clock on those two nights. Does that work?
I cannot be there, but carry on.
Carry on. Again, I know we have not formally closed the opportunity, because if there are individuals out in the community that would like to participate in that committee, it's an important one. Right up to the 11th hour, please submit. And if you know of individuals that you feel could be of benefit to the committee, encourage them to join.
And the second is also to establish a work session for the water and sewer budgets. We provided those to you at our last meeting, and my staff is available on June 17th, Saturday morning, from 8 a.m. till noon at the conference room. That would be the first tentative date. If we get through it all, then great. If we don't, we'll look to additional dates beyond that. But traditionally, we have been able to get through both the water and sewer funds in that time frame. And if you're all good with that, then we'll
What's your
look
pleasure?
Forward to seeing you. I know we're seeing a lot of each other this month, but, you know.
I'm out of town.
Okay. Except that's Saturday,
this
right?
Saturday.
Yeah.
Okay.
What's this Saturday?
I'm good.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Just want to make, let's get
it's
a head count.
This Saturday. I'm not here this Saturday either.
This Saturday?
Yeah, I'm not here.
Okay. I can make it.
I'm good.
I'm not going to be here.
We got to have a quorum.
Yeah.
I'll be there.
Yeah, but you know, these are big budget items.
Yes,
I want everybody to be joining in this fun opportunity.
So
the fun opportunity. So
we're missing your weekend.
Are we missing three of you? Is that the idea?
Three, at least three.
Well, then probably we ought to look at another.
No, we're missing three. Not more than three,
no,
right?
No.
So we have a skinny quorum.
We have a quorum.
Yeah, but you know.
Is that following Saturday not good?
I'm going to be gone the next Saturday.
No, that's not good. Okay.
And I think I begin to lose staff.
The 24th.
On the following week. So.
Can we do it during the week?
I was going to say it'd be a long night, but.
Can we do it in two different sessions? Two sessions.
Right? Sure.
I'd like to get it done, but.
5 to 9? Some evening?
Oh, don't go that far.
Let's not get overzealous. You know, we could have a quorum, but I don't think it's fair or appropriate for those that can't make it to just say, oh, how'd the board come out? We really should have.
Would
everyone
like
participating
there.
In it.
Yeah.
It's a big one.
Stuart
big
buys donuts and coffee.
Well, we usually provide donuts and coffee.
Yeah, that's pretty much
something
a given.
And coffee.
Maybe a steak dinner.
Gene's pushing for pizza on a weeknight, but.
I don't really want to, but maybe we should move the interviews with the.
Push them back?
The charter committee members and go
meet the 19th and the 20th for, on this particular subject.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
You lost me, but carry on.
Yep. You're okay with that?
I can't do the, I can't do the next
No, but you're okay with the...
Yes, yes.
Or, I mean, is there not another day that way?
Not being there?
She's not going to be available next week at all.
I see.
Right, next week.
So if we'll set it up. We'll start on the 5:15 on the 19th, and we won't hold you too late. And we'll get as far as we can, and then come back the following night.
Okay. The as far as the candidates or applicants for the commission or committee, why don't we move that to the next off week for so it'd be like.
Be the first week in July.
Second. July. It's going to be a little hard because of the holiday.
Oh, because of the holiday.
Yeah. Try to come up with some. Yeah. Because you're going to be probably traveling too.
Yeah, but you don't want to go. Yeah, but we don't want to go out that far out. I mean, they've only.
Yeah, but we're already into.
Do they have to be a Monday and Tuesday?
No. 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 The only reason I guess we suggested that was because of the off meeting week. Everybody might be available then. So, what's your pleasure? I don't think we want to have, like next week, four nights. No.
No.
Especially with Jeannie not getting the benefit of the participation.
That's not fair.
The following week we have a board meeting.
The 26th we have a board meeting, but perhaps the following Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And Wednesday we could.
Yeah. Here's what I'd like to do. The day we have the board meeting, set up appointments with applicants for 5:00 on that day, and then the following day, finish up or continue.
Okay.
Then we're all sort of around the same.
So June 26th and 27th for charter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. It's better. It's better that way. Any other calendar challenges?
No, I don't think so. I think that's enough on the calendar challenges. I just very briefly want to note that the PFOA issue is actually beginning to pick up some momentum. There may be some developments that are within or on the horizon, at least for a portion of the community. St. Gobain seems to be moving in the direction of accepting responsibility for some of the contamination in private wells. But on the other hand, and we knew probably, well, I knew this was coming, they also want to take a look at the former Superfund site, the Houghton Lane landfill. As you know, PFOA was found in some of our monitoring wells there by the state. The state and EPA have been analyzing the site, looking for additional information that may point one way or the other. And now St. Gobain has made a formal request to bring their engineers onto the site and do some of their own investigation. We are working with the state of Vermont and EPA reviewing their plan before we say, yes, you can come onto the site. But more than likely, they will have a plan that is acceptable to EPA and the state of Vermont. And what they're going to be doing is they're going to be looking at the area surrounding the landfill. They're not going to be poking any holes in the old landfill, but they want to take a look around at some of the monitoring wells, some of the additional soil samples that might be available to them. And they're also going to be doing some work along Houghton Lane, down along Apple Hill, probably along the East Road. They're going to be taking soil samples and those kinds of things take a look at where PFOA still exists in the soil and where it might exist in groundwaters. And then how does that play into their thinking as to whether or not they have full responsibility for it. So it's we're in the stretch on the one hand, and in the other stretch, which is where your neck gets a little tight.
A couple questions, Stu. Is there the DNA equivalent of a PFOA that could be traced directly back to what was the original Tanzator?
Chemfabs.
Chemfab. And did Chemfab at the time have the ability to dump PFOA at the old dump?
Yeah, they used our landfill.
Did anybody else?
There were a host of companies.
The Bennington
landfill operated from 1969 to 1987. It took commercial and industrial waste at the site. There was even an open lagoon that took liquid waste.
I remember the smell well.
So, yes, it rightfully belonged, when you look in hindsight, as a Superfund. And the capping and the work that was done there has really been effective, but we were dealing with different chemicals, and PFOA and PFOS and all of the associated perfluorocarbons are different in the way they interact in the soil and in water. And so we really are learning a great deal. The state DEC is telling me that with working with the efforts of Bennington College and their professors, as well as what we know from the hydrogeology of the area, that the state is developing a pretty good understanding of how PFOA moves. Whether or not that helps in the long run in resolving this particular problem for everyone who has a contaminated well effectively, or whether litigation will be involved, still remains to be seen.
Thanks.
And that's all I have.
That's all I have. Before we go into a executive session, if you would move in that case, because there's a matter that we need to talk about, which here deals with personnel, which is not appropriate for public participation. Is there any other matters that would come before the board, other business? Jean?
The only thing I wrote down was that the flowers downtown are absolutely gorgeous. I don't know who chose them, I don't know who planted them, but they're stunning.
Sweet William Garden Design is the one that designs them.
Who's that again?
Sweet William Garden Design, Caitlin Pettit, has a business over in Hoosick Falls. She's been our contractor for probably the last decade or more.
Gorgeous. That's it.
Carson?
Nothing for me. Carson? Just want to publicly recognize the girls softball team at Monanthony.
Yeah.
State champions. They've played the state championship 4 years in a row. They've won 3 out of 4, and they won an extra innings on Saturday. So congratulations, ladies. Great job.
Yeah. How about the lacrosse?
I was getting updates on Twitter. It was 5-4 at halftime. So
was it really?
I thought we were down, so I don't know. But, I haven't seen it.
It's
so.
Still. That's a good
great job. Come
want,
before the board.
Yeah. We could talk about that, recognizing all of
they've done great too.
The scholastic and as well as that.
Tom, I take it back. There was something I want to say.
Go ahead.
I want to congratulate the Pappas family and their daughter, who was the valedictorian of this year's graduating class.
I did see that. Yeah.
So that's pretty fantastic.
To all of the valedictorians throughout that report in the banner this morning about all of the commencements that went on, it makes you feel good that there's some really fine things happening in the area.
Yeah.
And we should be really happy, proud.
It was a great ceremony Friday night. The weather was perfect.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was telling them before the meeting, we, you know, people leave graduation as like a ending. And I was talking with guidance about, you know, what colleges students have been accepted to. And I was pleasantly surprised by the number of students staying locally accepted at Bennington, Southern Vermont,
really?
Community College of Vermont, and then regionally, Keene State, MCLA, Castleton. And I've got students leaving for Arizona, San Diego, University of Kentucky. Yeah. So it's great to see these students going off. And I'm excited, you know, going to miss them, obviously. I haven't seen my seniors all week, but it's been nice to see that they've going on to some prestigious institutions.
It is. It's a pretty special time of year.
Yeah.
Could I have a motion to go into executive session?
So moved.
Second. Second. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, signify by aye. 7. In 5 minutes, we'll be in executive session.
Okay.
That helps.